Before I get to the stupid quote, there are a lot of articles about how to ask programming questions, and you may have even seen mine. And I think these articles are great if you just want to structure and format an existing question. The explicit instructions make them really easy to follow, but the problem is that they don't say a lot about the thinking that should happen before you even start writing, and that's what this video is about. If you don't bring the right mindset to asking questions, it doesn't matter how neatly you format them. So having a clear idea of what goes behind asking good and bad questions will help you know what to look out for in yourself and others that you may be evaluating or mentoring. All right, now back to the quote, there's no such thing as a stupid question. My problem with this is that I think it's an overreaction to the word stupid, and by overreacting, you can completely miss the point, which is that questions can vary significantly in their quality. So I'm not saying that you shouldn't ask questions. My point is that you should strive to ask the best ones that you can, given your situation. And when you take specific measures to improve, a lot of the anxiety around asking questions goes away. So for a lot of you, this approach may actually lead to asking more questions, and that's because it allows you to directly address the root causes of your hesitation. To avoid any issues with language, I'll use good and bad to describe question quality. Now, if you've taught or worked in customer service, you've felt this intensely. When you get asked a question, your response can range from, wow, this person's great, I really like helping them, to this person is annoying, and I want this conversation to end. But what's behind this? I think it begins with the mindset of the person asking the question, and I'll illustrate by comparing and contrasting the two mindsets that lead to these drastically different responses, and I'll call them high performers and low performers. When it comes to responsibility, high performers ask themselves, have I done everything in my power to solve this? They try everything they reasonably can to figure things out on their own. Meanwhile, low performers think, someone should tell me what to do, and they do as little as they possibly can. When it comes to the desire to learn, high performers ask, how can figuring this out make me better? They know that figuring things out is where the real learning happens, not from being fed answers, and they don't want to miss out on these valuable opportunities. Meanwhile, low performers ask, how can I move on as quickly as possible? It's a passive check the box, go through the motions type of thinking. When it comes to resourcefulness, high performers ask themselves, do I really need to get someone to help? They only ask when they truly can't figure it out, and asking is a last resort. Meanwhile, low performers think, can I get someone to help? Asking is the first resort. They ask whenever they can. When it comes to self-awareness, high performers are deeply introspective. They think about how they can do better at every step, and they see everything as a lesson and try to squeeze everything out. Meanwhile, low performers, when it comes to self-awareness, there's nothing really going on. It's kind of a dead space, and they may not even understand the answer you give them. When it comes to friction, high performers are easy to help. Their questions are crisp and clear, and they remove unnecessary detail. The best ones make the answering experience enjoyable. Meanwhile, low performers make things hard. Their writing is difficult to understand, and it might require multiple conversations to figure out what's going on. When it comes to growth over time, high performers experience compounding long-term growth. They're firmly on the difficult but reliable road to increasing independence. Low performers experience stagnation, and things can even get worse as they solidify their pattern of dependency. Now let's consider the other side and imagine you're answering questions. When a question comes in, your impression of it, I think, is based on two things. One, did they put in a real effort to figure it out on their own? And two, did they put in a real effort to make the question easy to answer? Good questions must be a clear yes on both. When you see a good question, you want to help because it feels productive and rewarding. You help a little and you see a lot of growth. When you see a bad question, the instinct is to avoid because it's really draining to put in a ton of work just to see stagnation. And to add to that, there's the sense that the person doesn't respect your time, it seems like they don't really care, and there's probably going to be a lot of frustrating back and forth. To summarize, If I could distill this video to just three things, they would be: one, have I done everything in my power to answer the question myself? Two, if I must ask, how can I make my question as easy as possible to answer? And three, how can I reflect and ask myself all the ways I could have done better? Doing these things is the path to better questions, fewer questions, and ultimately independence.